That's not a study that we did. We simply put out a list, what school districts in Bergen County and others that we know of and nearby counties in New Jersey have salt quarters. But we don't have any more information than that.
Understood. And I'm going to, I don't know how popular this idea is going to be or not, but we haven't discussed in depth cardboard. If I understand that a lot of the things that I'm hearing, again, I'm trying to respond to the people's anxieties and, again, feel badly about that. Honestly, all of us are just private, not as private, but citizens like you all who want the best for the kids in the town. But I know that the anxiety of the not knowing where your child is going to go is like an extraordinary issue at play. So maybe this is all alleviated by just redrawing the lines. Now I understand that includes its own complexities, and that of course is going to include other people, a different crowd will come, for sure, at those affected. But again, I think it's an option that we need to look at. And I know it's something that we can't just decide here. We actually need to look at the numbers, draw lines, and that is work within itself. But rather than having anxiety for those parents and rather than having to have, are these volunteers in, that seems like a lot of work. Maybe we draw the lines and say, this is where everyone goes to school in Fairmont. We had to adapt, and this is our adaption until we can have a longer-term solution, which will be, I heard someone once say something about Edison, I think. That's a joke. Whether that be Edison or a larger solution. Okay? So that's what I got. I'm curious to hear what my colleagues think about that. So I'll pass the microphone and I'll start seeing.
On Jeff's point, I think that looking at hard quarters is something that we should do. I think that we should form an ad hoc committee, a couple board members and administration, and look at this map, because if you look at it, it's, you know, there's railroad tracks, there's highways, there's, you know, Bradford and proper. So there's a lot of factors to be looked at, but I don't think hard quarters is something that should be just taken off the table. I'm not sure it gets to where we need to be, but I think we should definitely look at it. Regarding the policy itself, soft quarters, from everything I've heard, it's not popular. So I understand that, and I was a proponent in the beginning that, hey, if you didn't register your kid, you're out of luck. You're not going to live here 10 years or not. I've changed my position on that, and I think that if we do soft quarters, and I think we probably have to, that people should be there on their houses in Fairmont before the cutoff date, whether they have kids in school or not. You own a house, my opinion, is that you should be grandfathered into your local street. So that's some anxiety. It doesn't get us everything we need as far as class sizes, but it stops the bleeding, as Dr. Pelesta said. There's nothing we can do about this year, but if we put it into effect next year, we have some flexibility for the new people to come in. If we get 150 new kids like we did last year, we're able to work on. So that's one aspect, the grandfathering. As far as some of the others, I definitely think, and I know this is more for the next part, but I definitely think that Edison has to be looked at very seriously. Even if we projection is 273 kids. That's Edison. Edison has a new elementary school. And I know they're going to be spread out all over the place, and if there's some contention about 65 kids, a little more too few, which is the consensus here, or is it too many, which was when I heard from another meeting that, nah, it's not even close. Like, you know, there's no way they have 65 kids. When I look at 139 bedroom houses, I've got to think, you could put 4 kids in each one of those, you could put 5 kids technically. Do it. So I think Edison has to be seriously looked at. I know we got the architect and things to be. And I think it should be a kindergarten center. I know that has its own problems. But it alleviates not just Bradford and Mills, but you've opened up, you know, 4 classrooms in one point. You've opened up 2 here, you know, Lindcrest, here at Forest. So I'm all for, and I'm getting ahead of myself here. I think that, you know, as far as soft quarters, you can grandfather people in that are here, make it voluntary if you live in one of those districts and want to put your kid in one of the smaller schools, we can do that. So that's my piece.
I agree with both Jeff and Junior. I was looking at the hard border, and I do know that hard border, changing the hard borders is a step, and it will have a room the same size, but I think the borders definitely have to be looked at. And the borders would have to be looked at anyways if we decide to open Edison as a traditional school, but that's not really what we're talking about tonight, or at this part of the meeting. But I do agree that looking at hard borders is important. I have some ideas. Either way, whether you grandfather everyone at a certain date, I was always at the, my opinion was always that if you register for kindergarten at the time, like we're registering for kindergarten for next year right now, if you go register for kindergarten before the cutoff date, you should be at your home school. And I for one, wouldn't vote for soft borders without some kind of either what Gene said, where you would grandfather everybody that's in the town right now, or the kindergarten thing. And I like the kindergarten thing better because it's longer term. It solves that angst longer term. I think that we should volunteer. We should ask for volunteers to that want to get out of the big class sizes, that want to go to a different school. I think that's a possibility. That's I've always thought that. And and as far as Edison, I have differences of opinion whether to open it, that, you know, which way to go. I think we have to look at reopening Edison, but there's a lot of costs, and there's a lot of costs that people, you know, out there just aren't thinking of because the staffing, and the size of the offices, the administrative offices, to move them somewhere, and that long-term rent and stuff like that, it all has to come into this picture. So as far as soft borders is concerned, I'm leaning toward agreeing. I think we need to do it with also residency verification. But I think we need to do it, but we need to also look at the longer term.
I'm leaning also toward the soft borders, but with contingent things with it. I think that the residents should definitely be more on. I also am thinking that there should be a hard registration deadline, and anybody that registers at that hard registration deadline is subject to being put where we need to fit people in. The volunteer to move your children, of course, is always a wonderful opportunity. If a parent comes and wants to volunteer with their child to a different school, I think that benefits all of us. I'm totally in favor of the verification of residency. I think that is something that needs to be done. And I also am a proponent in looking into what we can do with Edison. Off the top of my head, I say kindergarten center is great because it helps every single school in the district. The cost, that could be every classroom has to have that one. There's a lot of costs. Would there? And I'm not saying there would be order, but we'd have to look into the transportation of the children to that center. The warming, it's the staffing. The staffing that will come with Edison will be with us forever, as long as we have Edison as a school. So we have to take into consideration that.
Cindy, we can't hear you.
I'm sorry.
Thanks.
I was saying that the staffing for to put Edison on the map as a school, ever kind of school, because it's going to require staffing with dollar amounts that do not go away. They would have to be incorporated into our present budget. And that's what I have to say. The salt borders, I know it's not a happy proposition, but I think with stipulations, we can come to some kind of an agreement. Even if we only do a salt border policy for a period of time, and put in those stipulations about grandfathering people, we could work together as a group to make sure that we come to the best solution, which is the overcrowding of our kids. We need to address that. We can't have a classroom with 30 kids in it.
I mean,
okay.
First, the verification of residency by an outside company is essential. My second step would be that we would permit parents to voluntarily next year move their children from Radburn and Mills to another elementary school to alleviate their concerns about overcrowding. Third, I see soft borders as a short-term fix, which we may not need to have that policy last more than the 3 or 4 years that it would take to open Edison in some capacity. So I see soft borders as something that would expire once we determine or have Edison open to alleviate. I would like to see if we decide that it will take 3 to 4 years to do whatever needs to be done with Edison. I would like to see us drawing steps as to who would fall under the, not fall under the sort of orders, who would be grandfathered. I think that if you are presently pregnant, that's 5 years before your child would go to kindergarten. So perhaps you don't even need to be grandfathered, because perhaps the problem will be solved within the next 3 years. So I would see us have a short-term solution grandfathering within the next 3 to 4 years. Those people who already have children ready to enter the schools, with the fact that we could expand that if for some reason some building, the building was not ready for whatever we needed it to be ready for. So I see a phase-in process as very viable. And that's where I would stand on it.
I'm giving more and more thought at this time for hard borders. For those that are unfamiliar with hard borders, it's redistricting the schools. And I think that by doing this, you may even be able to save funding for the following years, especially in hiring new staff. I also heard that if we were going to consider doing the redistricting, that there would be an ad hoc committee set up. But I heard Gene say staff and administration. I think it's necessary. An integral part of this would be parents. The community must be involved in this as well. So if we go that route, I would like to see that.
All right, first of all, absolutely, it's not that I'm never saying no to volunteering. Anybody volunteers, because I volunteer a lot, so if you want to move a child, thank you. Verification of residency, we are very adamant about, because, yes, we are constantly looking at it. And, you know, if somebody has a suspicion, please notify us, okay? We don't have 26 truant officers running around town, okay? So we need your help. Because I hear that all the time when I'm all over town. Oh, I saw this person and this and that. And okay, so give us information, we'll investigate it. I am absolutely, positively grandfathering. I don't want any current resident to move from any school to another. You live here now, that's the way it is. I like what Cindy said about the, you know, hard registration. But, you know, the soft borders policy, in my opinion, is a band-aid on the problem. One of the biggest problems that we have to look at, I've heard everybody here tonight talk about reopening Edison. I've been in favor, we've talked about it in different forms, like we've said tonight, I don't want to be repetitive. You have to remember one thing. First of all, the answer to that man back then before asked about Mills, we don't have any room to add to Mills, so that's one issue that we have looked at. We don't have any room. Rather than we do, but that's a whole other situation. That's what I'm saying. We had a problem, you know, with the playground, so let's stick with that first. But the biggest problem that you have to look at, and again, I've been looking at since last Monday, long term, okay, I've been in town 22 years, is eventually all end up in one building, that's called the high school.
Yes.
Okay, and we're going to have to deal with that at some point where that could be overcrowded, and we did an addition. Okay, so this, you know, I want a solution like this tomorrow. I'm speaking for myself. I think my fellow board members also feel the same way. This is not going to happen overnight. Again, I am in construction. I have done school work. I am a certified school bidder, by the way. And I understand what the process is, and it takes time. Okay? And cost-wise, you know, like I said, we just did a $7.5 million addition to Westmoreland. That was an addition and some renovations. So to build a new school or add on, because even Edison, you might even have to think of adding on to that school, depending on how we go. Because if you have 400 kids in kindergarten going there, you still need a principal's office and nurse's office and other offices that have to be there. But as far as the soft borders, I definitely will not vote to move any current residents at all. I think everybody stays as far as that. And I'm also, like I said, it's just not the solution. I think we have to get through this year. We have to figure out what we can try to do next year to alleviate, because we do open up classrooms with kids moving up. But again, I am committed to looking to a long-term solution, and I don't even know if there is one out there right now with my fellow board members of what we're going to do so that 5 to 10 years from now we're not having this problem. And you know, you have to think about something. When I hear constantly about the property values, and I'm not an expert, again, I'm in the business, and I've spoken to some realtors that are here tonight, and I've spoken to other realtors in the business. People come to a good school district that raises the value of your home. Because I can tell you right now, if the budget failed 3 years in a row, your values will drop like rocks. Okay? And that's a proven fact. We'll look it up. So people are coming here because of it. So let's continue to grow it as a team instead of everybody attacking everybody, and see if we can find a solution together. That's the way I want to approach it. Thank you.
So I think we really need to be creative. I am probably maybe I'm the only one that's really down for reopening Edison. There's a lot that goes on in Edison. Everything that's going on in Edison would have to be placed somewhere else. So blanketly saying, let's just reopen Edison if it's $1.5 million or $2 million or $5 million or whatever, actually takes, never mind the board office, which would then be a rental for every year wherever we go, unless we maybe buy a couple houses and, you know, attach them together if the town fathers let us do something like that on some street in some neighborhood. That's a huge issue, because there's a lot of people that work for us on the other side, not the education side, and they have to be somewhere. So I definitely think about that, displacing them and every other classroom that's currently being used in Edison, which I want to guess is every classroom. So that all has to be moved somewhere else. And if there's no room in any of the schools that are represented here, then there's no place to put whatever we have at Edison that would have to get put somewhere. So we have to find a place for them as well. So that's my thought. But I also think it's time to be innovative or creative. If you're going to open Edison, if that ends up being the decision, and I'm a consensus person, because I stated what I just stated publicly, and if I lose the battle, I will vote for the solution, because that's my role. You put me here. So I'm going to try to do what's best for all the kids in town. But the reality is that there are buildings in town that might be empty, that we might be able to put classrooms in. The people that live in the, or go to the Radburn School, that were supposed to go to the Edison School, 30 years ago that have been going to Radburn School for, what, 25 years or whenever Edison was closed, 36 years ago, okay, because of that. So, you know, what if we took that zone, which already was a zone, and was supposed to be maybe temporary, but ended up not being. And let's say we found a building, you know, I don't know, on the other side of town by Fifth Street, I don't know, wherever. And, you know, bust those students over to that new building instead of changing Edison or building a new building. Maybe there's a building in town that we can, you know, buy or recover or whatever and create a new school. Like, I haven't driven around and looked. I mean, we have real estate people here. They might know if there's available properties. You know, I think we should be looking into that. When you talk about having a committee, you know, I think that's what the committee should be doing, look for viable options. You know, Edison might be an option, but in my mind, I don't think it's the only option. And my second thought on the topic is, if that does become the option, you know, I'm not so sure that putting, I don't know, 300 kindergartners on buses to get them over to Edison is as good an idea as maybe, you know, taking all the fifth graders and bringing them to Edison, which is also less expensive because you don't need a bathroom in every classroom, and the rules for opening a kindergarten, you know, there's like 100 things that have to be in every kindergarten room that don't have to be in second, third, and fourth grade rooms, you know, the counter heights and all that stuff. So it might be smarter to look at moving older kids, and I say this with half a heart because I remember when we reopened TJ, and I sat on that side of the, which is why I became involved, but I sat on that side and I was arguing to make the kindergarten center because my kid was just getting to the age where he was going to be able to walk to school by himself, and now he was going to have to get a ride to TJ. So I bought a house so my kid could walk to school, and you know, from when he got into sixth grade, I had to drive him to TJ every day. And so, you know, like I get it, but I also think that that might be a better option because they're older and they can deal with, you know, being on the bus and all those other things. There's different problems for little kids and for larger kids. So that's my thoughts on the subject.
I have a question. Do you know the apartments are going to open in Radburn?
I talked to Dave Bostock. Did you talk?
You were with me.
Yeah.
I talked to Dave Bostock here, and I was talking to somebody else.
So, what do you say, 3 years before the first?
About 2 years before the first one was
started. Okay. The other thing is that when I look at the house of sold and location, it's not only in the Radburn and the Mills area, there's a great number of houses being sold in Lindcrest and Warren Point. So, it looks as though those schools might be overcrowded too, so that might not be a solution to move the kids to those schools. I mean, in my neighborhood alone, in the last 2 weeks, there, and I live in the Lindcrest area, there were 14 houses for sale in the 3-block area. So I don't know if that's the only schools that are going to be overcrowded. So I think we have to take that into consideration when we're looking into what we're going to do with these small quarters, because there might not be room for those children to go to a different school. I mean, that's, you know, that's the way I'm looking at it. I don't know. Is there any way that we can talk to the realtors and find out what houses were sold and how many children are going to be put into those houses? I don't know if there's, you know, some way to find out, you know, how many kids before they have to register.
It's very hard, you know, I've heard everybody saying about the demographics. And if you look at those companies, there's formulas that they use. There's nothing precise and there's nothing exact. Because again, you don't know where people are going to move and how many people. You have a family of six move here, you might have a family of one. So you can sit here all day. These are just bases that we're going to look at. I understand what you said about the 139 three-bedroom apartments. I agree with you. But there's also no guarantee that every one of them is going to have kids. Because you could have somebody moving in with their in-laws and they could be staying there too. So we can't sit here and say an exact number. But we try to get a parameter of what we are going to look at and what we're looking at ahead. Mary Letter.
What I forgot to add when I was talking was hard borders. And I do think we will eventually have to look at hard borders if if we decide, whatever we decide for Edison, or maybe Elisa's idea of another whole building. At that point, I think we have to look at hard borders. But there's no reason we can't look at them sooner, Mike. And the only thing I'm concerned about, I believe things should be voluntary, and I believe people should be grandfathered and all, and so forth. My question, is that enough, Ernie, to take care of next year? Is it enough? Or are we basically grandfathering so much that none of the problem is alleviated next year?
Let me respond. It's a very good question. So first let me give a rhetorical sense. I mentioned to some of the board members after the last meeting, is there anything I would have said differently or added to it, and it's this. If we don't do soft borders, what happens in September? We're going to be in big trouble. If we get the kind of numbers that we had last summer, the summer before that was an increase of about 170. So I think soft borders is going to give us time to accommodate the kids while we look at the other good ideas that we have on the table here. But if we don't have soft borders and some flexibility in place, and remember that one of the most important concepts that the board is talking about is everybody in this room gets grandfathered because you're already here. So as new people move in, we need a place to welcome. And so what I'm saying is, as new families, non-existent families, move into our community, where am I going to put them in September? I know that there are some grade levels that they cannot possibly go to. Right now in Radburn Mills, we're also seeing similar class sizes. We've been talking about classes in 27, 28. We have a lot of classes in the district, 23, 24. That are getting there. Soft borders will at least give us the possibility of not having 29, 30, 30 kids in the class in September because we have an option. If we don't have that as an option, then we're going to be in the status quo position, which is how we started this year. And that means we'll have 28, 29 kids. And I know specifically in Mills, where we thought we had it pretty much solidified. We did add a paraprofessional, and then in January, two more students moved in on the grade level, and then another one came in. So remember that we have a couple of dynamics with student enrollment. But my biggest concern is we get a big influx over the summer, and we're starting with 28, 27 kids, and we have others with 24, 25. Where are those summer kids going to go? The only solution that I think that's realistic, and that's also not going to cost a lot of money for the community, is soft borders. And again, the grandfathering is a part of that. So nobody negatively, in terms of your child, is moved. It's the new child moving into the community where residency has not been established. I don't see that we have a choice. That's my analysis. I don't see that we have a choice. We have to do this, at least for next year, because I think the numbers are going to be.
A few questions. I don't know if this would be for Natalie or more of an education question. But in terms of the classes that are already in Edison School, are those classes there specifically at Edison School? Is it reasonable for those students to be, if they have to be moved, is it reasonable for them to be in a more inclusive environment? Or are we just running into another problem about where we place those specific classes? Meaning, can we still provide the same level of special education to those students who are there in a different environment? So I think that's a pretty important question.
Because if the answer is no to that, then we're dead in the water before we go forward.
My assumption is that they could be educated very well in our borough schools.
Okay. Right.
But in our classrooms would be moving out of some of those schools, though.
Right.
So if we chose to open up Edison, right, because that's why you're concerned about where those classes would go.
Right.
So if Edison were to be open, classes, yeah, let's just assume kindergarten. We have 16 kindergarten classes moving out of the six buildings to move there. We might need some of those classes, but I don't know.
Right. I guess I'm just a little concerned that to satisfy one community, we could be disrupting a community that already exists. That is, I would say, and I apologize if I say this the wrong way, maybe less adaptable than other students. So I just want to know that we're, and I know we are, I know us, and I know where our hearts are, but I think that rock needs to be turned over as a discussion to make sure that we're not hurting anyone.
And from what you're saying is exactly that we absolutely need to consider that, and I don't think it would ever hurt any of our students.
Okay.
Specifically those students at Edison, if they're not really being sacrificed.
Okay.
In order to make space, never put that in. Okay.
Thank you for that. Two other quick things. I know Sydney, you maybe made a combination earlier. About having a hard registration deadline, right? And I think that maybe also we could combine that thought, and again, to if we were going to go to this soft water route, we could alleviate again the anxieties again, which I think is important for us to do as a board. Maybe we could do that by having a hard registration date, by saying, so then the realtors and other people who want to move into town can say, where if this is a date, then they can say with certainty, if you move now between these dates, you're going to go to this school specifically. So this way, that can be advertised, saying this school after this date, or this house for this date is that school. So there is like some type of reasonable explanation that you can give to that. So I think maybe that could be part of our equation. And I also want to know, realistically, how long do you think it would take us to redraw hard lines? Like, would that take us, do we do that for next year? Is that realistic?
For next year? I don't think it's realistic. I think during next year we can do it.
That's all I asked.
I just want to clarify one thing about the policy that's adopted. There was some concern from Lincash parents that you're going to take five kids out of Radford and put them in my school. Now I've got 25 kids. But I'm looking at the numbers now, and there are some grades that are chock full, second grade at Radford. So I think what would happen is, if you come in and you're late, you don't make the deadline, and you're not going to get into your home school because there's only 25 kids in there. We're not going to take those two or three kids and cram them into another school, so that's where that's 26. There's three other elementary schools of varying sizes, varying degrees of class sizes. I mean, Radford and Mills obviously are the Saturn and Neptune of the Fairlawn solar system. They're so big. But there's other ones. I'm looking at Lindcrest, and it says here 13 and 13, but at this point I spoke to the principal, and it's like 17 and 19, so kids moved in. So you kind of, but they have 23 and 23 in third and fourth grade. So it's not like you're going to take those kids and move them in, and now you're met. There's, if you look at Forest, it's 18 and 18 and 17. So there's a lot of flexibility as to what school is going to get the extra children. So I want to allay any fears that we're going to all of a sudden take the Radburn Mills overcrowding problem and make it now is the West Side Towns problem. We're not planning on doing that at all. And as far as, let me, Joanne, how many classrooms are in Edison? How many do you think are there?
12.
21
12.
12.
12.
How many classrooms are there in Edison right now? Total.
12.
No, including the offices. If everybody left.
Including,
21.
There's 12 classrooms and there's one child place.
Okay, and there's 16 kindergartens?
Right. 16 kindergartens, which means...
You have five to about 500 left to do.
Well, and I want to add to Jeff's question before. I mean, I know people have been talking about kindergarten, that's fine. I mean, as an educator, if we ever went in that direction, I prefer to call it early childhood. Because if we look at the classes that are there, some of the classes that are there are age-appropriate to stay in Edison. So if we have a preschool handicapped class, it would make sense to keep those students with their age-appropriate peers, because we have no other preschool handicapped. See what I mean?
Yeah.
And so if you have your special education students, actually, it could be 3 years old, it could be four, most would be five. They would be in the building of age appropriate. That would help with how we staff and how we manage, how we equip it. So early childhood is, I mean, if I were using a word, I would look a little different from kindergarten to look at, because then what it does is it keeps some of the Edison kids who are already there, maintains them there, because if it's 21 and 16, now that would be this year's number. If it's 21 and 16, and we carved out an office there, you still have a surplus. We only, you know, looking down the road, maybe in 2-3 years the kindergarten is more than 16, maybe have 18. That is as quickly. But if you look at it more as a broad-based early childhood, that's another way. Because then it protects the special ed kids who are ages 3, 4, and 5, and they don't have to move to another building.
I think we definitely have to take care of the special needs population, and we need to come up with a solution with that alongside everything. I think what we have to do tonight is come to a decision about what we need to do in the immediate future in order to alleviate the overcrowding for the 2017-2018 school year. A lot of good ideas, and those ideas are going to have to keep going forward, okay? I have an opinion about fifth grade, but I'm not even going to mention it now because we need to worry about this problem. So I think the two things that need to be done immediately is we need to decide if and what the soft border policy is going to be, and move forward with the verification that was already decided on. The board already voted on that, I believe, right? That was voted on. So that's happening. So I think we need to do those two things and to get it done.
All right, well, I just want to, anybody else? All right. As far as the board, then, with the team thing, you agree that voluntarily, you agree with the verification. Is there anything else that somebody wants to add to that side to that we all agree on? Well, grandfathering?
Grandfathering is still
anything else? Yes.
Real quick, you know, about if we do the soft border policy, policies in it, just in the word policy, they can be revisited at any time. So if we see that the policy isn't working, that could be revisited and changed, and it takes a couple of board meetings to do it, but two. But they can be re-looked at any time. So.
Hold on. I'm just going to go down the list.
I was trying to take notes. So this is what I heard the board members say. And then I think the question was, know, do we put this in the category where the board is agreeing on? So I heard a conversation about looking at hard borders through an ad hoc committee. I'll just take a nod as yes. So grandfathering?
Yes.
That means everybody who currently lives in Fairlawn is grandfathered. Looking at Edison?
Yes.
Registration deadline? Remember last week I talked about July 1st as the registration deadline, so bouncing off Jeff's idea that would provide the real estate folks some time to talk about that. Somebody else talked about soft borders, the policy for a period of time.
Yeah, at sunset of some sort. So when I called the Paul Green, he said he doesn't see why you can't put that in the policy at sunset July 2020, whatever it is. He didn't see any Paul Green was the board attorney. He said he doesn't see any policy.
There was conversation about starting an ad hoc committee to look at the whole issue.
There's a hard work committee and then a committee made up of board members, members of the public and administration to look at fifth grade in kindergarten, K-5, at Edison, buying a building, whatever.
Thank you.
There was a conversation about looking at that existing building in the community. It could be part of that committee. And the lesson that I wrote down was providing choice when signing the schools. In other words, if there's a student who would come in after July 1, they would be going to a school where there's space for them to go, and not necessarily designating. In other words, you have some kind of choice. They can say to the parents, that's right, if there are two schools or three where there's room, which one would you prefer if you're one who registers after July 1st? That was the list I had. So the board agrees with those things.
Okay. You know, have to call you a long-term thing before the committee just to consider to look at the numbers, and will also maybe help alleviate our middle school problem. Is why not have one of our middle schools become a 5-6 school and the other middle school become a 7-8 school?
Well, but I wanted to add something that was said last week. We'll talk about whether there's a consensus on that. Somebody asked a question last week, and it went something like this. If you are one of the soft border policy families that started after July 1, and you really like your kids in that school, and now it's time to go to middle school, what would happen? And administratively, we were brainstorming about this during the week. Our feeling is that we could support for those families who choose either one of them. Because some would want to go to their neighborhood school, and some would want to stay with their friends. And then there's
suggested that people that bought a house that was, let's say, across the street from Radburn School on Radburn Road wouldn't have to go to Warren Point because they bought a house across the street, because of proximity. You know, it's different if you live further away and you move in more later. That was a suggestion that was at the last meeting. So I think that might also be something that should be discussed if somebody's living across the street from the school. Right, that's something that might have to be put into the policy as opposed to, if they're living on, Jordan Road, and they're going to Radburn, it wouldn't make a difference if they went, over the hills or if they duck us or had to be driven to Warren Point because they move in after the date. But if they're moving in across the street, that might be something that we need to, discuss.
I'm not opposed to discussing it. I think we can set a hard registration date, and if it was July 1st, I don't think you can then turn around and insure somebody because they live on this block or that block they're exempt from. So, I mean, the big concept that I think many people did not, but we've continued to talk about, the big concept is your grandfather is here, but if you move in later, even if you're across the street from the school, in districts that have run soft borders, you can still be assigned if that class is filled to one of the other elementaries. I mean, if we start doing that, then you're making the decision based on your geographic proximity to the school as opposed to when you move in. That could, then we're back to where we started.
Anybody else? All right, at this time, I'm going to open up to the public. Please line up. I'm going to limit you to 2 minutes. Please do not. Please be polite to everybody, and I would appreciate if you could try to keep to the same, not to the repetitive statement over and over again. It's getting late. You all want to go home. So let's just get on the cross in 2 minutes. And then let's move on to the next speaker. Just please state your name again and your address. Thank you.
To establish a master plan. And that means that you get professional advice from architects, realtors, forecasters, geographers. You get all that information and you make the decision based on long-range master plan. Children and stability go hand in hand. The instability of soft borders should not be considered as a permanent solution. Stability for our children and stability for maintaining property values must remain the ultimate goal. What I had asked, which I didn't hear anything about answered yet, was what is the status of how overcrowded the middle schools are currently? Because if we were to take all of the elementary schools and resettle them for K through 4 in elementaries, 5 through 8, in middle schools and leave 9 through 12 in high school, you're in a sense leaving the same exact amount of students that are there now and just moving them into a school that may or may not have more classroom or real estate to share it. That doesn't add additional administration staff or additional principals, and it also keeps all the kids with their children, with their friends, and it keeps the hard border policy and the stability in check. Building additions should not be discounted because if you do a master plan, they might say that the middle schools can accommodate 5 through 8 if you add, you know, one addition for the cafeteria, let's say, versus if you try to redistribute based on Edison or another elementary with an addition, you might be paying like $7.5 million for 8 classrooms when you can just do a, let's say, $1 million addition for a small added cafeteria. So all of those decisions can't be made without a master plan. I think that if you do a temporary solution now, it needs to be exactly that temporary. A soft borders policy should be included in the language that it's revisited at every term, at every single term. And I also think that it should only apply to new residents. You can't say a person living across the street from a school because what you've just done is given an unfair advantage for property value for someone who wants to know me more or whatever. They can encourage that and someone can sell their house for twice as much. So there's no stability in the listing work in that regard. And the last thing that I want to add is that regarding the redistricting of the schools, the new developments absolutely should be reconsidered on the district map so that you can strategically place these larger influxes of students that are coming in. I think that's a no-brainer. I don't know if you guys were considering that today, specifically not just redistricting everyone, because then you're going to have a whole group of fair one again. But the new, every single new development should be subjected to being placed in a zone that makes it even, that keeps everything balanced. And I just implore you to do a master plan and make decisions. I didn't hear anybody talk about it, and without all the information, I think we're shooting ourselves in the foot.
And I just want to say to you that, yes, I have. You got to understand something. We have talked about it. I spoke to Joanne about it and stuff. Again, to get all of it together, we have to also look at, again, figures that some people go into a budget or where we have money, but we can take out a capital reserve because they're not going to just tell us for stuff for nothing. So it was a $250,000 study. We have to look at it, but it's definitely something I agree with that we definitely should do. And again, like you said, even with the landmark, yeah, we have to understand and we have to talk about it as a board where we're going. We, you know, again, we go to a lot of meetings and we talk about a lot of different things. And I'm not trying to insult anybody, but sometimes people don't realize that because they're not there. They might not hear us. They might not see it on the website and every little thing. So, but we definitely provide part of your recommendation up to the board.
Okay, thank you.
And I wanted to address that master plan idea. I think it's a wonderful suggestion. And one of the things, we just didn't talk about it, but the Board of Education had a retreat on a Saturday a little while ago right here in the high school. And one of the things that we approved is the concept of moving forward next year with the board developing a strategic plan that would address a number of areas. The first area that was on the plan is attendance areas, attendance zones and attendance areas. So that part of it, the board has already considered. We stand committed to probably with a facilitator, or maybe we can do it ourselves. But we had several items that would become a 5-year part of a strategic planning process. And that's a good process that districts use. Some use 10 years, I think that's too far out. But attendance is already going to be a component of that as well. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Emma Sharker, and clearly this has been discussed very much so in the last meeting today. I'm very much a numbers person in what I do for a living, so I circulated a survey on the various Facebook groups just to understand what are the statistical relations to the sentiments. I think it's very important for the board members to understand. And I can tell you that across school zones, almost no one was for the proposal. Definitely not in its first state. Maybe it was with some modifications, so I think it's very important to know. The other piece of information is that the importance of school rating also came across as a top 2 box for favorability for anyone making a decision to purchase a house. And the last thing was the top reasons for buying a house, the rating of the school came up number 1 again, all school zones. So I think it's very important to mention this. I'm going to send the email out with the results of the survey, but please take this into account. We asked many questions in the survey. I think the results are going to be very important to take into account the results. Thank you.
Thank you. I will say one thing. When we do go over all our test results and all our scores and where we get them from, it's an educational meeting, which our educational meetings are phenomenal. I hope to see a lot of people there because they'll really learn a lot about it, how the rankings are, because you know what? There's a lot of variables going into the rankings too, with the different type of kids in each school, special ed, ESL, so on and so forth. So we like to explain that to everybody, and if anybody ever has a question about that, you can feel free to call back to us, the score, Mrs. Latina. We'll be more than accepted, but I appreciate you sending us that. Thank you. I'll have to look at that. Thank you.
Hi, again, if you ask me, I'm in the middle area. First thing I wanted to comment is on Jeff's earlier comment regarding the other towns. I don't know all the towns, but I did check some of the towns where self-board policy were implemented. And in Ridgewood, Glenmore, Farms, Livingston, and Tenafly, there is no
such difference in the school ratings as well as in real estate values and real values across town like we have. We have significant differences in real estate values and in school ratings in school zones. So that's one other issue, but it's a fact that we're looking at disputes out there. And I understand what Mr. Rogel said regarding how the ratings are done. I get that. Unfortunately, marketing is everything. I'm sure you all know that. And that's what people look at. Whether they're right or wrong or correct or incorrect, it doesn't matter. Because that's what people look at when they buy their real estate. So the reason why, and I haven't checked whether there's any significant drop in values in those towns, but those towns do not have the that we have that is really risking our real estate values. So another thing I wanted to say is regarding hard water solution, I really do believe that the developer alternative is specifically, and I know I said that before, the landmark development should absolutely be assigned to a private school, not to put additional strain on our schools. I think I represent a lot of people specifically in my community where we would like to see a commitment from the board to work on the Edison solution as part of any South Board policy that, and make sure that the South Board policy, whether it's adapted or not, is temporary, absolutely temporary, with an expiration date. And I know I've heard 3 to 4 years, and in the first meeting we said 2 years, so I don't think 3 to 4 years is temporary. 4 years is definitely a time where we can get things done because I've heard estimates on 2 years and 18 months as well. This policy must be temporary. I think we have to absolutely consider real estate values may never recover if they drop significantly following such a stock board policy. People choose certain schools don't, not just the district. They do choose certain schools don't. Both due to the school ratings and community, and we do have differences in our school zones.
Okay, well, can you just, we have a passage around one.
And I just have one other thing that I wanted to say that if property values do drop, keep into account that all of the people that their value drops in the community will appeal their taxes because their valuation is going to go down, and this water rating and all of our schools in our town will lose significant revenue. So I really implore the board to reconsider the stock board policy and do everything that we can. My last question
is that
I have a PhD in business, and I've been running companies for 25 years with more than $100 million budget, and I have to volunteer my time easily to help with anything that I can. And there are two realtors in this audience today that are happy to volunteer their time and help relocate the offices.
I spoke to him. Thank you very much. I appreciate your response. Thank you.
Hi. My name is Claudia Simonoso. I have a couple of questions, one following another one, because it does all
personal.
If it's not a secret, I think most people are probably not at least of the ages, so you know, not very bad to get that.
Excuse me. I have kids.
No.
Okay,
I'm
so I'll say no. That doesn't matter because we care about every school. I don't know that.
And you were in the school, and the fact
exactly what it says, and real estate agents will have to be aware of everything that's going on. Right? He can apply. So he will say, you know what? I don't know which school you're going to go. I don't know where to buy a house.
All right, so let's get to your question.
My question was, what is the case decision? I can send everyone with the payroll. I don't care what policy is.
Who makes the decision on what? I don't understand the question.
I want to know which area district you guys make the decision, right? You work in education. I want to know how many of you guys are given a reference of the area. One person.
Two, not to be embarrassed.
Mark does two.
So you made a decision about people who was evaluated in the office and right there.
Well, can I just say something? Everybody, please calm down. Okay? I'm going to answer your question very simple. Okay? In two stages. Number one, there's not one member of this board that does not care about every child in every part of this town. That's number one. Number two, I gotta be honest, okay? Let's throw the soft border policy out right now. Let's hypothetically. That still does not have a bearing, this board doesn't have a bearing on the value of your home. That's the market that we're in, okay? If somebody bought high and the market falls down, it's like a stock. That's the way it goes. So, but yes, you are. You're saying that we don't care about the value of your home. You know what? We care about the kids first. Then we go to the values, okay? I'm a little insulted by that because I'm on this board and I had this discussion with people after the last meeting. Well, here you are. You say that I don't care about the value of Radbar and Milton Mills? Yes, I do.
How about this? Okay. How many of you guys are in the room?
Just like three of
us. Three of none.
It's a third. Somebody wants to do it. I really appreciate it. I have to walk with this. No, that's fine. Just say your name and address. Thank you. Thank you.
A little bit of retrospective. I don't have a bulletproof vest, so I don't also wear this. My wife and I, we moved here 32 years ago solely for the school system. We were living in Central Jersey, loved it there. It was not as built up as it is here, but I wasn't happy with the schools. My daughter was a first grader. We moved here, my daughter went to Harvard. It was at a mile. I was really struck by, I don't know if he's here today, the mother of a special needs child that goes to Edison. And I'm very concerned. All my children are healthy, my grandchildren are healthy, so I don't have any personal vested interest in the special needs, but I'm very concerned that all this doing something for Edison. What's going to happen to the special needs children? Apparently, this is a phenomenal program. I didn't know that at the last meeting, so please take that into account.
We specialize our work in our house. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Julia Gellman. I'm from the 33rd of Black Hill and in the district. So I just have two very quick questions and then I'll say to Pam. So I think it's the last meeting either way, but maybe this is not, but I'm just curious. I work in the city, so I treat people like the city schools. Are trailers an option at all?
They would have, like, if they're existing, they're okay, but you can't, it's too many variables.
No, it's
a good question.
And then the other question, so we have to do so that no one can vote on you. Is there a way to build up to no one?
If you want me to answer that, the problem with building up on any school, okay, is you pretty much have to close that school for the construction. Because you got to realize, we had this with West Wallen. They thought about going up too. You have guys working over them. I can't have them working from 4 o'clock to midnight. You can never get the job done against even the construction. So unless you can isolate a section and do them in sections, and even then, you need to with those kids. So yeah, that's a thought process. And part of something, I'm just speaking for myself, again, being in the business that I thought about of moving, let's make Milnes, like put a memorial over the Milnes, make it one giant, but again, you have classrooms that are already set up for middle school. There's middle school classrooms and stuff. So, but it's a thought, but there's just no room over there.
No, I thought about
the
summer.
Yeah, there's not enough time for the construction, unfortunately, but a good question.
So, I have two kids currently in Milnes, and one 3 months to the school tomorrow. And my second grader is in our high school 30. So I am super concerned about this regarding, because I know that the education is just not, it's limitation to the education. I could care less about myself, but the value of the reference of education. My concern about borders is that I'm almost on board that it's not enough. For example, my class 30 classroom, okay, it will make it so that it doesn't go up to 132 but it's not going to be enough for third, and I'm worried about that. So in that point of view, I kind of almost like hard orders more because I feel like it's more of a result of that. Also, the software issues, the more people you grandfather in, and that was not the question that everyone grandfather is trying to bring here. I'm just saying, in a numerical perspective, the more people that you grandfather, the less of an effect it's going to actually have. So, that would be something I would like the hard borders to get. Maybe one of those houses that is affected by the hard border change, I'm rezoned, it is what it is. Bottom line is the education of children. So, I just say that very first. As far as Edison, I do think it's a good idea, whatever way we find space. When I do sit here, I understand that the emergency is bathrooms and what have you, but what I don't remember in fifth grade is that the typical undergrad students go to middle school as sixth graders. And I wonder, a psychological point of view of having those kids move for fifth grade and then move again for sixth grade. So that's the reason I'm thinking that. And lastly, just a big picture, obviously, something going much more forward. So they just want to put out there, talking about allocating money and big construction. Maybe what really makes sense, great, but big picture, is building a new high school and then moving the middle schools to their high school space, and college schools to middle school space, and really, really thinking about that future. It's obviously that's huge money, but it's going to be a lot going forward, and maybe something we can think about where it really can go up to the entire school district. Thank you for taking the
overcrowding seriously. We're taking it very seriously, and your idea is good. It's a lot. It's not something we can do overnight. We're thinking, like you said, but the thing I do is saying, I know the board feels the same way. The most important thing right now is the education.
Excellent.
Thank you.
All right, very nice. I just want to say one sentence. To answer the one piece about overcrowded classrooms now. So at the beginning of the conversation tonight, we talked about the budget, which includes two general education teachers. So we'll have some flexibility to reduce current class sizes. That's on top of whatever would occur with sophomores. So we have not given up on, we're not looking at sophomores as the only solution. Really, the board's following a pretty eclectic approach. Some reliefs through the budget, some reliefs through soft borders and keep it minimized. But if we're able to get that teacher approved, that's going to help somewhere in the bigger buildings.
That would be great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, the man all the way is in the back. Oh, he's going to be the last man. Okay. I'm a finance speaker, our residents.
Thank you. Thanks. The second thing is that whether it's Edison or something else, it's our agreement that capital improvements is going to be part of the solution. And I think just an hour or 2 hours ago, it seemed like it was a budget decision that limits you in the future. So I would ask that you reconsider that when you, vote on it next week. And also that when we vote on the software policy, whatever you end up with,
that's not a problem. And just to answer your other question about the budget, like they said before, the budget is already, we've been through for the process. Now we're looking at the 17-18 budget. This is the two things you saw, one and four, are how much more we can add to the possibility of doing Edison. Now, again, and we can all agree to the one, too. We might need another $7 million if we're going to go ahead and do it. So I agree with you, but we're going to take that into consideration.
If you go out for a referendum, I get it's different, but yeah. I think you're building a sort of cushion to not do that.
Trust me, I wish I could come up with a lot of money tomorrow. All right, thank you.
Hi, I'm
we need to see how, I have to look at the best options. So we have it, decided where, but what we're going to try to do is take the largest class size and reduce it.
Thank you.
I just wanted to give some ideas. I know the cater cannot be used for the kids, but might be something that we can use for offices. So maybe something to take into consideration for a future thing. I also don't know if the town or the school system can do a census, so we have a better idea of what our population is. And if that could be built into that big project, thinking of the future, to do a census to make sure how many households we have and how many kids do we really have as a kid, and what are the projections for the future. I don't know if you can clarify for me, in the deadline for registration, I registered my daughter for kindergarten, and it was a couple of weeks ago. But for the rest of the elementary school, it's April, I think. So how is that deadline beneficial to you to plan ahead? If you move everybody to register earlier rather than later, so you can plan ahead for how many classrooms are you going to need to have, and just something that pops into my head. Maybe if you have that number earlier, that will give you some room to understand what you're facing in the next year. And lastly, I also believe you should go with the question number one. Because that will shorten the time if you go to the borough editor or if you go to buy a new building and send in another amendment, it will shorten your time by a lot. So just something to take into account. Whether you go one route, a cheaper route, or a special route, you will be short $500,000 I just want to say thank you for finally mentioning the kids at Edison, because my son is at Edison, the kids in the bus program. He's not a kindergarten, he's in fourth grade. This is a wonderful program that works at Edison. It works in that environment. Honestly, I don't think it would work in another environment. I really don't, especially for my son. I only think for my son, but I know that it wouldn't work anywhere else. And I do trust that you're taking all the consideration, every child in the district. And I am a very selfless person. I'm on two PTAs. I volunteer. I give money. I do tons of things for schools and for kids all of all abilities in this town. I love this town. I grew up here. When I was growing up, Memorial High School, I'm a lifer here. So I just wanted to really say thank you. And I know that you will take consideration of these children and that you're not going to start construction. But I really feel like behind me, you are going to come to Edison with sledgehammers to start construction. Oh, perhaps my kid off. And it really is not a big deal. And so I just really want to say thank you tonight for taking this into such high consideration. Thank you. I first want to mention a comment that I got from another parent who couldn't be here tonight, who has three, maybe four kids, I think, and she will have a kindergartner in 2 years. She has a child at Barn Point currently in kindergarten, and she has a child at Westmoreland in the Stepping Stones program. So, given the opportunity of the kindergarten center becoming a realization, she will have three kids in three different buildings. Managing is doable. I do it now with one kid at Edison and one at Westmoreland, but it's not easy. It would definitely be more convenient to do the whole staggering, and just as Jamie had mentioned, and I just want to reiterate that, because I told that mom I would definitely bring that to you guys. And then as far as my contribution here is, I have to be on Team Edison for just a hot minute. I have a daughter there who's in the preschool program now. She will no longer be there after this year. However, there's a lot of kids that are there, and they range anywhere from 80 children to 100 children. Enrollment has fluctuated since I've become involved.
So we're going to go and say a magic number of 90 in between somewhere. Those children need OT, PT, and speech choice, and they need like a coordinator for their stepping stones program, and they need a psychologist, you know, to have private space for counseling. They need a lot of things that shouldn't be overlooked when Edison is chopped up and turned into something different. I also want to speak to the flex classes. That's something that I have been looking into for the past like year and a half as far as why flex is placed at Edison. Some parents said that they like the idea, some say they don't. Bottom line is through just talking to people, staff, and parents alike. The bottom line is flex is there for a reason, because that smallness of that school works for them. The chaos of the cafeteria, the chaos of recess does not work for those children. I don't know how many kindergartners will be at this hypothetical kindergarten center. It sounds to me like 300 kindergartners is chaos. I'm just going to assume that it's not going to be very quiet in the structure. I think those things and those points need to definitely stay in consideration when making decisions on what happens at Edison, and I'm definitely on Team Elise with let's look for different buildings and let's leave Edison alone for a little while. Thank you.
Everybody agrees on the board that we are looking at it, not necessarily Edison, something with a physical plan to work on alleviating overcrowding on a long, medium, and long-term basis. And we're not sure exactly what that is, but in the next few weeks, we'll schedule another meeting, we'll sit down and go over all the ideas that we talked about. That is one. So I was thinking about it tonight, but at 10 to 11, I don't think it's probably
that
time. So
yeah.
You can focus on the policy.
Yeah, so basically the policy is we have all the notes. We're probably going to rewrite it to what we've talked about, what's been sent to us, everything else. We'll get a copy out on the website. And then at that point, we'll, again, even if we vote, it has to be brought. It's not going to be brought to this Thursday's meeting. So it probably won't go until the next meeting before we have to vote on it. So that's where we're going to stand with that. And we are going to continue to look at, like Gene said, all the options. I will say once again, I greatly appreciate it. I'm speaking hopefully for the board, but we appreciate all your input. Everybody played nice tonight, pretty much. Okay, but again, I will say it one more time. Please get involved in your local school. Get on the PTAs and the PTOs. Get involved. Come visit the board of election. We're a little small one at the time, but we enjoy your input and learn. And like you said, if you have any questions, the website pretty much tells you where to go. You can email any one of us, the superintendent, or anybody, and they will be more than happy to answer your questions. But again, I appreciate everybody's input tonight. And okay. And Cindy wants to say something, but thank you all for coming and drive home safely.
I just wanted to reassure you that everybody on this board is very committed to the special education of our community. They are little butterflies in the humans that we have. And as special ed chair, I give you my word. I also just wanted to make a clarification before, because I was thinking that maybe it could have been misconstrued, and I really don't want that to happen. When I was saying about the fact that the scenario would require no referendum, I was under no way insinuating that I did not think that the people of this community had a right to say. My concern about the referendum was what would happen if it went down. And then we would really be at square one again, with more time not doing anything. It in no way said that I thought that you guys didn't have any input, that it should never go out to a vote.
You guys are elected.
But our